The following episode is the account of Artie Guzman, used as an executioner for La M. It is an excerpt from chapter 25 of my book, Mexican Mafia, The Gang of Gangs. It was a very foggy night in Signal Hill, California, as I drove the hit car with an East LA gang member aboard. Arthur Guzman, also known as Artie from the King Kobras, was a game youngster who came highly recommended for this particular assignment by my brother Angel. Driving southbound on the 405 freeway, we were heading from East LA to a Long Beach suburb to undertake a contract hit for Helen Mrazek, our bail bondswoman. The target was Bob Mrazek, her husband. For Artie's benefit, I had my game face on and glanced sideways as he carefully checked the weapon I provided him, a 45 caliber automatic. It was a perfect night and I was very confident bringing Artie on board for this assignment because he possessed previous military experience and was a notorious street shooter. I asked if he was prepared to rock and roll. Wearing a serious look, he said he was ready. Artie slid the gun into a leather pouch and zipped it up as I commandeered the stolen 1976 green Cutlass off the freeway. We drove slowly alongside a golf course, searching for a street sign, and could barely make it out in the thick fog. The sign read Goldenrod. I turned right and drove less than a block where I carefully swung a U-turn and parked the car. These were the days when cell phone GPS guidance systems and MapQuest were not at our disposal. Instead, I used a Thomas guide to help pinpoint the house. I still marvel at the precision in which we conducted our business without today's electronic luxuries. Artie and I looked at each other with amusement, and I arched my eyebrows and widened my eyes in mock horror at the heavy fog that obscured everything around the vehicle. Artie, too, opened his eyes wide, trembling slightly, simulating and pretending that he, too, was afraid. I then produced a notepad from the console, checked my notes, and shared some brief intel. Bob, our intended target, drove a black Dodge pickup with monster wheels. Unable to see anything within a few feet from us, the blanket of thick fog prevented us from making out anything in Bob's driveway. I produced the house key given to me by Joe Morgan, who acquired it from Helen, and I handed it to Artie. I instructed him it was the dark brick house on the corner, the house you can't see right now because of this friggin' fog, I told him. I gave him the exact address on Ironwood Drive. Bob was not supposed to be home until after 8. We simultaneously checked our watches. It was about 7:30, which gave us plenty of time. I further instructed him to exit the car and walk casually. I assured him no one would be able to see his face in this fog. I told him if the truck was in the driveway, which it should not be, to come and get me and we would do this thing together. He understood. If the truck was not there, he was to use the key, unlock the door, and have the 45 ready, because you don't want to be naked when you walk in. Although no one should be in the house, I didn't want him taking any chances. Once inside, I told him to close and lock the door from the inside and wait for Bob to arrive. Having already shown him the photo, Artie had a visual of our target. I explained every detail and Artie knew what he had to do. The kid was cool as an ice cube. Giving his impersonation of Arnold Schwarzenegger, he said, "No problem, I'll be back." I reminded him when the job was finished to walk and not run. I told him to make sure the piece was in the vinyl bag, zipped up, and to carry it naturally and enter the car like no big deal. Artie indicated he understood. In a way, he reminded me of me. One last thing. I looked intently at him and told him, "You make sure he's dead." I extended a clenched hand and our fists met as Artie nodded his understanding. Artie exited the car and quickly disappeared as he was instantly swallowed up by the night fog. Artie walked up the driveway and spotted the address number on the front of the house. There was no vehicle in the driveway. He walked up a cobblestone path leading to the front door, quickly inserted the key into the door and carefully opened it as he unzipped the bag containing the .45. He closed the door, making sure not to slam it, locked it, and continued to an area in the living room that offered an excellent vantage point for him to survey the front of the home from the inside. He glanced at his watch. It was 7:40. Suddenly, large headlights illuminated the front of the house, and Artie retreated into his area of concealment. Two trucks rolled into the driveway. Doors slammed shut, and the vehicle lights were extinguished. Several voices could be heard approaching the house. They were complaining about the fog. Bob Mrazek entered with several men who followed him to the dining room area, located next to the room where Artie was concealed. Bob hit the light switch in the dining room. Artie heard the front door close and saw a tall, overweight, bearded cowboy-looking guy walk into the kitchen. He returned with a six-pack of Budweiser, distributing them as everyone shouted approval. Bob then unlocked a large cabinet and produced and passed around AK-47s plus other automatic rifles for everyone to hold and admire. One guy whistled approval and everyone had an appreciative remark to contribute. Artie could see the activity from his hidden dark corner by peering into a mirror that clearly reflected the men drinking beer, each cradling and admiring a weapon of destruction. Artie carefully checked out his volatile surroundings and kept both hands clasped around his .45. To me, it seemed like a mini eternity. I glanced at my watch and looked back in the direction of the house. The fog made it impossible to see anything. It was 8:15. Although I saw the trucks pull up, I couldn't ascertain if it was Bob's house or not. I sat put. Inside the house, a black and white cat sauntered into the dining room where Bob and his friends were drinking and whooping it up. Scurrying past the partygoers and into the adjoining room, he glanced curiously at Artie. Upon spotting the unwelcome new arrival, Artie bared his teeth and hissed quietly in an attempt to scare the cat away. But the cat did not budge and inquisitively cocked its head at Artie as Bob called out for Patches, the pet cat. So Artie could see Patches, Bob and his companions could see Patches, Patches could see Artie. Artie could see the guys congregated in the next room, but the guys did not see Artie. Patches squirmed and slowly headed towards Artie, seeking his attention and affection. Artie tried fanning the .45 in an attempt to spook Patches, but the cat didn't budge. Someone joked about Bob's cat having found a rat, and everyone laughed. Artie reacted to the remark with a frown but stood his ground in the shadows. He knew this was not the time to come out with blazing guns, so to speak. Artie then heard someone complain they had run out of booze and suggesting a beer run. Bob suggested they go to a nearby pool hall instead. Everyone voiced unanimous approval. Bob collected the weapons, returned them to the gun cabinet, and they filed out of the house. I saw the headlights as the truck sped past me and careened around the corner. I once again wondered what was going on with Artie. Suddenly, there was a knock on the front passenger window. Artie's face pressed against the window as I unlocked the door. As he climbed into the car, I quickly strapped on the seatbelt, started up the car, and drove off with a series of rapid-fire questions. Artie slipped the vinyl bag into the glove compartment, fastened his belt, and related the account. This would not be Bob Mrazek's night to die. A few days later, Artie Guzman, my brother Angel, and I said very little as we drove to Norwalk to access the stashed hit car, the Cutlass Supreme. I had rented a station wagon at the Valley Rent-A-Car in Alhambra to use in the final getaway. We knew what needed to be done after Artie and I had been thwarted at Signal Hill. Artie double-checked the .45 automatic I had given him earlier and verified the clip was full with a bullet in the firing chamber. After locating the cutlass, Artie and Angel rode together and followed me to Signal Hill, a small town next to Long Beach. Per my previous instructions, we parked in a restaurant lot a few blocks from our intended victim's workshop. They jumped into my rental car and I briefed them thoroughly. Artie and Angel were listening intently to my instructions. Angel would drive the hit car and he was Artie's backup. I confirmed both of them were armed. I handed Artie Bob's business card, which read B&M Carpets. I pointed out the business location situated next to an office building and told him it was a custom auto upholstery place. For about the 100th time, I showed them Bob's Polaroid photo. For the 100th time, they studied it. Artie assured me he was familiar with Bob's face. Angel would drive and park in the lot next to B&M Carpets. Artie would walk in and ask for Bob. After positively locating Bob, Artie was to briefly engage in a previously rehearsed discussion about having his van upholstered, and during the conversation, he was to blow him away. Then he was to walk away briskly, not run, with the gun displayed for all to see. This would deter any potential resistance. He would return to the hit car and Angel would drive away from the crime scene. I reiterated they bring their cuetes, their guns, upon returning, and I would ultimately dispose of them. Artie and Angel both responded, nodding affirmatively. The last words I said to Artie were something like, "I know I already told you this, but I'll say it one last time. Make sure he's dead. When you leave the shop headed back to the getaway car, make sure the piece is back inside the bag. Walk quickly, but don't run and don't attract attention. Don't look into any office windows. Look straight ahead and Angel will start the motor once he sees you coming. You drive off as if nothing has happened, and if you see a cop car, you still don't panic or do anything that's not normal." And then to Angel, "You drive off slowly and don't make eye contact with anyone. Okay, let's do this thing." I stressed to Angel his sole responsibility was to remain completely calm and oblivious to everything and everyone. He would drive but a short distance at a normal rate of speed to my waiting station wagon. He would park next to me and I would drive them away. Artie and Angel departed, both casually exiting the car, walked to the hit car and drove to the industrial park. It was my brother Angel who had recommended Artie for this job. On the streets of East LA, Angel had an established reputation as a deadly shooter also. Angel holds the distinction of being the second street gang member to carry out a street execution for the Mexican Mafia. This occurred in 1976 at the behest of Joe Morgan. Artie was not only a close street friend of Angel's, he respected and looked up to him and considered it an honor to be asked to undertake a murder assignment. Artie winked at Angel and strode casually toward the shop. Angel was parked in the adjoining lot next to Bob's shop and checked his gun in the unlikely event Artie would need his backup support. Joe wanted an alibi for himself. He had a court appearance on that day and asked that the hit take place, if possible, between noon and 1 o'clock, the precise time he would be in court with his attorney, Bob Harris. The noon hour had indeed arrived when Artie approached the first man he encountered for direction to Bob Mrazek. Bob was conversing with a co-worker when Artie entered the work area. Bob's partner spotted Artie first. Artie asked for Bob, and he pointed to a husky man who was tinkering with a slot machine. Bob turned and greeted Artie with a smile. Satisfied this was his man, Artie returned the smile, unzipped the vinyl bag, and produced the .45 caliber Army issue automatic. Artie placed the gun up to Bob's head and fired one round. He died instantly. His co-worker covered his head protectively and cowered in fear. Artie told him, "Today is your lucky day." He told him to cover his eyes and count to 100. "Then you can call the cops." Artie slid the gun back into the bag. He turned and walked away as the loud reverberation from the gun echoed inside the shop. Artie walked back to the hit car and they drove off to the restaurant parking lot where I was waiting. Everything had gone like clockwork. According to Bob's co-worker's account to the police, everything happened in about 20 seconds. I saw the car as they parked in the space next to me. They exited the Cutlass and casually headed toward me as I prepared for our extraction from the area. They entered the vehicle and I instructed Angel to remove his shirt and stuff it into the glove compartment along with his .38. I told Artie to remove his sweatshirt and give it to Angel along with the vinyl bag. Artie complied and Angel, who was in the front passenger seat, stuffed Artie's sweatshirt and the bag containing the murder weapon into the glove box. I handed Angel the key to lock the glove compartment. He locked it and returned the key. Should we get pulled over on a fluke, I was prepared to drop the key into the space between the car's door and window. This would prevent the cops from snooping inside the glove box and later testifying I had given them consent. They would have a difficult time convincing a judge they forced the compartment open without probable cause to search. It would not hold up in any court. Artie and Angel fastened their seatbelts and acted normal. Any cops responding to the initial call would be looking for one or two male suspects, one with a green sweatshirt, Artie, the other in a plaid shirt, that would be Angel, in a green Cutlass Supreme. There was no probable cause for us to be stopped, so I reminded them to be cool, and if they rolled up on us, I would do the talking. We drove away without incident and merged onto the 405 freeway. After dropping them off, I drove to Leg Lake Park in South El Monte. There, I disposed of the murder weapon by hurling it into the lake. The textbook hit occurred precisely as I had planned and choreographed it. Having done this many times on my own, I had anticipated all the moves and covered all the bases. The job was done. What Artie Guzman will probably never know is that after the hit, Joe suggested we take care of Artie, the game youngster who had successfully taken out Bob for us. First, Joe wanted him and I insulated from putting in any more work because it made business sense to keep us out on the streets. So going against our practice of having anyone but us commit our homicides, we used Artie. Then apparently, Joe starts having second thoughts about using a non-MA operative. As I've stated in other episodes, it was always the easiest route in solving a Mexican Mafia dilemma by killing it than to give it a second thought. I agreed we should do this, yet I felt compelled, as a courtesy, to tell my brother of what I was about to do to his friend. His response was unexpected. Angel literally begged me not to kill Artie. Angel assured me Artie would never talk about this and would put his life on the line for Artie. You got to understand, in that time frame, Artie was nothing more than another game youngster, an expendable associate willing and eager to put in work for the fellas, coveting the status that comes with committing a 187, the ultimate act of murder. When I shared Angel's request for mercy with Joe, who thought the world of Angel and tried to recruit him in 1976, except I nipped it at the bud, he told me he would honor Angel's request if I was in agreement. We spared Artie, and Artie never needed to know. In an ironic twist, Joe would years later raise his hand to sponsor Artie into the Mexican Mafia. The game youngster who once served a purpose for us as a shooter, who Joe and I were looking to take out, discarding him like an undesired selection on a dinner plate, the wide-eyed teenager who wanted to put in work for La M and gain favor in our eyes, Artie would ultimately become Joe Morgan's mijo, his son. Artie Guzman would eventually evolve into one of La M's most powerful members, a mover and shaker of the Mexican Mafia's Pepsi generation. But that's another story we will feature in another episode on Artie. Once again, the message to you Sureños, no matter how hardcore you think you are, at the end of the day, your life literally hangs on the mood and whim of a big homie. If a Bat Marquez, Alfie Sosa, or any other lifer wakes up one morning on the wrong side of his prison bed and decides you know too much MA business or have served your purpose, you are expendable.